Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Professor Rekha Pande from the Department of History in the University of Hyderabad. In this module, I'm going to talk about women and bhakti, which is part of the course of women and history. In the earlier module, I was talking about the whole background of the bhakti movement, how it emerged, and what was the attitude of the men towards women in general. In this module, I'm going to talk about the few women who came up as part of the bhakti movement and what is it that they were writing, what were their thoughts on, and what is it that they wanted out of life. This becomes very important because generally we do not have much from the point of view of women. But here we have a vast area of information about women writing about their experiences. So when we examine the role of women in the bhakti movement, we can see that the women were exploiting the religious emotion to deal with patriarchy, and they created an alternate space for themselves. They challenged patriarchy and the mortal man to whom they were tied in a relationship of marriage. And they extended this relationship to God, understanding of God and their relationship with Him. They looked upon themselves either as a lover, a wife, a mistress, a friend, or a servant of that God. Through centuries of patriarchal control, women have negotiated many layers and levels of existence, and they have worked out various forms of resistance through various mediums. But many of these have gone unnoticed in historical records. Bhakti was a very important medium which was open to women. Since religious space is the only space available for women in medieval times, many women embraced bhakti because it provided them a space to define their own truth in their own voices that revision society, polity, relationships, and religion. It provided a sanctioned space for ecstasy where all the existing rules and orders of the society could be transgressed. This whole study of ecstasy in bhakti provides us a very important understanding of bhakti in its formative stages, and a study which has been done by Fiddleham Hardy in his Viraha Bhakti. Women's articulation is often at odds with the dominant male voice, which is the only voice which is heard in traditional historiography. Now, if we look at the medieval society, as already mentioned in the earlier module, medieval society was a society where far number of changes were taking place. You had agricultural expansion, large-scale craft specialization was taking place amidst a political background which saw the emergence of a large number of regional kingdoms. The socio-economic preconditions for the rise of the Bhakti movement can be located in a set of interrelated and widespread changes in the production patterns that affected the socio, cultural, and political arenas, which were then reflected through the religious sphere. Now, Indian society has always been patriarchal, and for most of the recorded history, with stages of disabilities against women increasing. Though it has often been stated, you know, and you will find a large number of books talking about this, that the position of women was much better in the Vedic period, and things started deteriorating only with the coming of Muslims. We cannot deny that even ancient societies were patriarchal on the simple count that the predominant structure and values of the society were oriented in giving men a superordinary status, a fact which is reinforced by the sacred literature of that period. We can posit the argument that this trend continued in the medieval times, as we get no evidence of any sharp structural disjuncture from which halted patriarchy. In fact, one can see it continuing in modern times, and this is one of the reasons why the social reformers and freedom fighters took up this issue as one which was an unfinished business of the Indian social reform movement. Now, the biggest question comes is, if we are searching for the historical figures of these bhaktas, women bhaktas, then we hit a wall, because there is very little information available on them. Yet, many of these women bhaktas go beyond the shadowy realms of the past, and they are very much alive in popular culture today. In fact, you can even turn to any class 9th or 10th textbook, and in every regional language, you will have some of the songs of these women bhaktas. Therefore, we have to turn to collective memory and remembrance, which are based on their bhajans, which are still very popular today. And you can hear them everywhere. And there are a large number of poems written by these women. It is from these that we get few glimpses of their lives of these women. I do recognize that there would be a lot of interpolation of these poems. And yet it does give us some sense of what these women were writing. Now, if we take the example of Akka Mahadevi, she was the daughter of a rich merchant in the village of Udutal in 12th century. She was a great devotee of Shiva, and she grew up to be a beautiful young woman. Then the chieftain of the land, whose name is Kaushika according to tradition, he fell in love with her. Now, Kaushika was an unbeliever, and he forced Akka Mahadevi to marry him, much against her wishes. Now, legend goes that she told him that she would leave him if he touched her thrice against her wishes. And when he does so, she leaves him. As she forsakes him, she breaks all marital relations as well as her clothes, and she walks out naked. Another important women bhakta is Lal Date. She lived in 14th century in Kashmir. She was married at the age of 12 to another Brahmin family with surnamed Nikka Bhatt at Pimpore. We have a large number of legends which talk about the cruelty meted out to Lal Date. She endured this torture for 12 years, and finally she also left home. Padmavati, as Lal Date was known earlier, is supposed to have danced naked, singing in frenzy. She now came to be known as Lal Date. Lal in Kashmir, referring to the lower part of her belly, which increased in size and hung loose over her private parts. Another very well-known bhakta, in fact, she has a pan-India presence, and this is Mirabai. She lived during the end of 15th century and beginning of 16th century. In fact, among all the bhaktas, it is Mirabai who is much well-known among the people. Now, tradition has it that as a young girl, Meera pestered her mother to tell her who was her bridegroom when she saw a marriage procession. To avoid her persistent questioning, Meera's mother pointed out to a statue of Krishna and told him that this was her bridegroom. When she grew up, she was married into a royal family of Sisodia Rajputs of Mewar. Now, Meera even refused to consummate her marriage regarding herself already wedded to Krishna. This was an open defiance, and her in-laws could not tolerate this. There were various attempts at her life, and finally she left the palace and started staying independently in the temple in the palace compound. But here too she did not find solace because of the lot of her association with a large number of saints. And her constant presence in near the palace. She then started moving around with other saints, and she started associating with them. And she moved out into a temple complex associated with Krishna. Now, the other bhakta whom writing we get is Sahajobai. It is generally agreed that she was born in 1683 and she died in 1765. In fact, even many of the verses attributed to Sahajobai describe her hard work, like she does grinding of corn, carrying of water, sweeping, digging. She says that one can walk the Guru's path only if one is a brave warrior and frees oneself from the fear of death. Many of Sahajo's verse are collected in the Sahaj Prakash, one of the major texts of the Chandradasi sect. The other two famous bhaktas of Gujarat are Diwali Bai and Gora Bai. And many of their songs have been documented in Gujarati and English anthologies. Diwali Bai was a Brahmin widow and from Deobhal. Her father was very poor and therefore he left her in charge of the saint Dadu Guru Bhagwan, who was a devotee of Ram, and hence he taught her the whole Ramayana. Gangasati is another very important bhakti poetess of Gujarat, and all her compositions have been handed down to us in the oral tradition. In fact, all of this was written down at a much later stage, and we get some rough accounts of her life from these. Now, Gangasati was a deported Rajput woman, and she was married to Kaluba in the village of Samdiala in Saurashtra. Kaluba, according to legend, was asked by his fellow Rajputs to prove his faith in bringing a dead cow back alive. He started chanting and singing, invoking the god to perform this miracle. And according to legend, the cow did come back to life. But after this, he decided to take a Mahasamadhi and renounce his life because he felt that he would not be allowed to practice bhakti for its own sake and everyone would expect him to perform miracles. Gangasati also wanted to join him, but he prevented her, saying that she had not passed on her knowledge and wisdom to their daughter-in-law, Panabai. Now, Gangasati composed a set of 40 bhajans or hymns for this purpose, and this is the only recorded case of a woman who is respected for her knowledge and she passes it on in a formal way to another woman. Another very important saint is Sant Toral, who is the better half of the famous Jaisal Toral pair, known as the legendary lovers as well as the saint pair. Now, Toral was a Kanti woman. She was married to Sant Satya, who was considered to belong to a lower caste than the Rajputs, but they were also a martial race. Now, Jaisal was a Rajput dacoit from Kutch who dared to acquire Toral. According to legend, he dared that he would acquire three things, that is Tati, Toli and Toral. Tati was the famous sword, Toli the famous mare, and Toral the woman known for her beauty and piety. One day, according to legend, when Toral was distributing prasad, there was one extra helping left. And when they searched, it revealed Jaisal, who then told her husband Sansatya why he was there. And he wanted to take Toral with him. Now, Sansatya willingly gave away his wife and mare to him. And Toral also agreed to go with him because she was born with a mission of changing the lives of three fallen women. Now, whatever the legend, we need to remind ourselves that Sansatya very willingly gave away his wife because the wife was always a chattel to the husband under the patriarchal system, and she was his property and he could gift her away to whomever he wished. Now, on their way to Kutch by boat, there was a heavy storm which came and it began to rock their boat. While Jaisal was terrified of death, Toral remained very calm and she addressed him in bhajans which teach that the attachment to the material world is pointless and one must find a rescue in bhakti. Jaisal confessed to his sin, and these included robbing the wedding processions, killing bridegrooms, stealing and dragging away grazing cows, hunting deers, killing peacocks, and letting down his sisters and their children. And as he kept on confessing his sins, the storm started subsiding and the boat finally calmed down at it stopped. Another very important woman bhakta is Janabai. She was a maid servant and her period is believed to be between 1298 to 1350. Now, According to legend, she also had a very difficult life. And many of her abhangs in, the poetry which was written by the Marathi saints, they talk about her daily grind of life, her work, which included cooking, cleaning, washing. And as a result of her whole day labor, she hardly found any time for herself. In the daily grind, it was Lord Vithoba who became her constant helpmate. He is there to help her carry the water, prepare the bath water for her. He would help her in sweeping the leaves from the courtyard. He would also scour the vessels till they gleam, and he would scratch her scalp when the lice irritated her. See, she is a maidservant and her daily life is around these issues. So all her poetry is also talking about her day-to-day life and the daily drudgery which she has to bear. Another very important saint from Maharashtra is Bahina Bai, and she lived during the 17th century, and she is the only woman who is known to have written an autobiography. This has been translated into English by John Major, and she was born of a poor Brahmin family of Degaon. When she was 3 years old, she was married to Ratnakar Pathak, who was 30 years old, and he was a priest and astrologer. Obviously, for Ratnakar Pathak, this was a second marriage, and for Bahina Bai, this was her first marriage. Now, at the age of 7, Bahina Bai came to Kolhapur to live with her husband and parents. Here too, she had to suffer a lot due to her bhakti, and she is the only woman saint who continues to remain married. See, all the other women walked out of their marriages. They left their husbands, they left their homes. They walked out either moving in the company of saints or just, renouncing everything. And Bahina Bai is the only woman who continues to be married. And her life becomes easy only when her husband gets converted to her way of thinking. So, if a reading of the poem of all these women, it tells us how difficult their lives became after marriage. Many of these women were born into rich families. They led very comfortable lives prior to their marriage. Their problems start only once they get married, and they are not allowed to do the things the way they want. In fact, they are troubled by their in-laws and other family members because a daughter-in-law is the property of that family. And many of these families see these women as bringing shame to them. I'll read out some of the poems. I'm using the translation by A.K. Ramanujam on Mahadevi Akka. And Mahadevi Akka writes, "I have Maya for mother-in-law, the world for father-in-law, three brother-in-laws like tigers, and the husband's thought are full of laughing women. No God this man. And I cannot cross this sister-in-law, but I will give this wench the slip and go cuckold my husband with Hara, my lord. My mind is my maid. By her kindness, I join my lord, my utterly beautiful lord. From the mountain peaks, my lord, white as jasmine, and I will make him my husband." See, here is a woman who is, in a period, 12th century, when the god, husband is to be regarded as a god, she writes, "No god this man." So she's openly defying and saying that she does not treat her worldly husband as a god. And again, she talks about her conflict, her day-to-day life, her bhakti coming in conflict with what is expected of her. She says, "Husband inside, lover outside, I can't manage them both. This world and the other, I can't manage them both. Oh Lord, white as jasmine." She refers to Shiva as Malikarjun, or, which has been translated by A.K. Ramanujam as Lord, white as jasmine. She says, "Oh Lord, white as jasmine, I cannot hold in one hand the round nut and the bold pear." At another place, she says, she talks about her daily problems. One point she says, and again, this is such revolutionary words coming from a 12th century women saint. She says, "I love this handsome one. He has no death, decay or form, no place or sight, no end nor birthmark. I love him. Oh, mother, listen. So the Lord, white as jasmine, is my husband. Take these husbands who die and decay and throw them into your kitchen fires. See, to her, Mahadevi Akka, it is the Lord who becomes her husband, because he cannot be destroyed. There is no decay. Whereas the earthly husband will die. So, you know, she puts all her relationship into that heavenly God. Again, if we look at the life of Laldade, we find that she also had to go through a lot of difficulties after marriage. She's scolded on slightest pretext. She's not allowed to spin yarn on the spinning wheel. Though according to legion, she spun a yarn which was as fine as the lotus stalk. She was often ridiculed for not doing anything right. She was often taunted as to what she had learnt in her father's house. We have among her saying that they may kill a big sheep or a tender lamb. Lala will have a lump of stone all right. Again, she writes at one place, you know, one has to bear lightning, flashes and thunderbolt. One has to tend with pitch darkness at midday. Now, Meera also faced a lot of problems. She talks about her marriage, you know, in one of her poems, she says, friends, marriages of this world are false. They are wiped out of existence. Wed my indestructible one. The serpent death cannot devour. You know, she's almost talking like Mahadevi Akka, that there is no point in being married to a mortal man, because these relationships are going to destroy. It is only when you have a relationship with God that it is going to be permanent. She again, you know, talks a lot about how she is fighting against the social norm. She says, I constantly rise up, go to the temple and dance, snapping my fingers. I don't follow the norms. As an oldest daughter-in-law, I have thrown away the veil. You know, women were expected to remain in parda, be behind veils. But she has thrown out everything and she is out in the open. Again, you know, just like Mahadevi Akka, Meera also talks about her constant conflict between her bhakti and what is expected of her through society. She says, oh friend, I cannot live without the delight giver. Mother-in-law fights, my sister-in-law teases, the Rana remains angry. They have a watchman sitting at the door and a lock fastened on it. Why should I give up my first love, my only love? Meera's God is the lifter of mountain and nothing else pleases me. There are so many stories, you know, how Meera was, you know, there were attempts at taking away her life. Her in-laws family was not happy with her bhakti and they wanted to kill her. So she talks about this in one of her poems. She says, friends, I'm completely dyed in this Krishna color. I drank the cup of immortal bliss. My inebriation never goes away. However many millions of ways I try, Rana sent me a basket with a snake in it and Meera put it around her neck. Smiling, Meera hugged it as if it were a string of pearls. Rana took a poison. Find Meera, he said. Give it to her. She drank it like Chanamit. Singing the praise of Govinda, I drank the cup of his nectar and nothing else pleases me now. Again, if we turn towards the autobiography of Bahina Bai, we can see the kinds of problems she had to face after her life. You know, she starts her autobiography by stating, I am now 11 years old, but I have not had a moment of joy. Again, she states, I had no independence and my wishes had no effect. I was very depressed in spirit. My daily life was full of troubles. A common theme which runs across the lives of all these women is the restricted space they have in their married home. Suddenly, all these women find that they do not have any freedom and they come into conflict with their in-laws family. And this is primarily because when they want to lead a life according to their own wishes. In fact, there are attempts at trying to imprison them, lock them, even poison them. They are harassed for not following the wishes of their in-laws family. Because according to a patriarchal society, you know, a woman does not have any independence existent. She has to completely change over herself and followed the diktats of her in-laws, family after marriage. In fact, in one of her abhangs, Bahina Bai comes across as being very rebellious and a bold person. She refuses to abandon her bhakti in search of truth. You know, in one of her abhang, she writes, "The Vedas cry aloud, the Puranas shout, no good comes to a woman. I was born with a woman's body. How am I to attain the truth? They are foolish, seductive, and deceptive. Any connection with a woman is disastrous." Bahina says, "If a woman's body is so harmful, how in the world will I reach the truth?" So a common thread which we can see running across the life of all these women bhakta is the restricted space which patriarchy provides them and the kind of treatment which is meted out to them in their in-laws' house at the hands of their husbands, their sister-in-laws. It is now, you know, all of them turn towards bhakti because bhakti is the only way which provides them some kind of space. You know, they move out of the restricted physical space called the house and they move into the realm of this larger spiritual space called bhakti. And in this whole process, they get freedom and independence to follow whatever is their wish. For all these women bhaktas, the rejection of the power of the male figure to whom they are tied in a subordinate relationship becomes the terrain of struggle, self-assertion, and alternative thinking. A glance at the writing of all these women bhaktas show that they are spawned by patriarchy and then bhakti becomes an outlet for them. It gives courage to these women to outpour divine melodies from the heart, articulating their concerns and singing in unfettered voices of their own. Though many of these women saints in medieval India had emerged from an atmosphere of discrimination and oppression where patriarchal values are still held in high regard, many of them charted their own course and in the end they emerged as individual with a mind of their own. And this was possible due to the space provided by bhakti. Many of these women saints sought to escape patriarchy and the demands of domesticity by creating an autonomous space and also not being termed as wayward or loose. Because, you know, whenever women do not fall into these brackets, it's very easy to call them wayward and loose. But none of these bhaktas are called wayward and loose. And they went out, you know, on long pilgrimages. They went to different holy places. They traveled all alone. In fact, this demonstrates the creative use of tradition as both an element of protest and also to carve out some personal spaces for themselves. Another very creative use of tradition, which was later on picked up, was this whole notion of the sacred hymn. Karikalai Ammar asked God Shiva when her sorrows would end. The creative use of tradition to posit a relationship between God and the audience borrows from the notion of mantra as a sacred verbal sound. Since the mantra is objectively effective, the success of the ritual is ensured. The use of emotion was adopted by these women whose songs became very popular and they put forward their views and desires. In fact, in these songs of these women, we see a reworking of ritual and the whole way tradition, they are responding to musical tradition to respond to creativity according to their own needs. Many of the women saints adopt the path of bhakti and they stay away from their married homes. In fact, Meera regards herself as being wedded to Krishna. It is the only space offered by bhakti. She could come out in open defiance. She says in one of her poems, "If Sushodhya is angry, what will he do to me?" You know, it's an open defiance. What can he do to me? Though Sushodhya is a king, but she says, "If Sushodhya is angry, what will he do to me? I will sing the virtues of Govind, my friend. If Rana is angry, he will stay in his own country. If Hari is angry, I will wither, my friend. I don't care for worldly position." You know, so if the fight is between her husband being angry or her God being angry, you know, she's not bothered if her husband, the Rana, is angry. But if God becomes angry from her, she would totally wither away. And all these women cast off the notions of decency and modesty, you know, which are the linchpin of a patriarchal society. It is through these, you know, notion of decency and modesty that many women are subordinated in the patriarchal society. Akka Mahadevi has the guts to shed all her clothes and walk out naked. She says, "Brother, you have come drawn by the beauty of these billowing breasts, this brimming youth. I am no woman, brother, no war." So, you know, openly she is talking about this. Janabai also states in one of her poems, "Let me not be sad because I am born a woman. In this world, many saints suffer in this way. Cast off all shame and sell yourself in the marketplace. Then alone you can hope to reach the Lord." So, you know, very clearly she says that if she has to leave out all her modesty to reach God, and it does not bother her, because, you know, reaching God is her ultimate aim. Meera also, you know, talks about her restlessness. "Friends, the dark one glances like a lover's dagger. It struck me and I grew restless. I lost all sense of my body. Pain spreads through my body. My mind is intoxicated. I have found few friends. All of them are mad. The chakor loves the moon. The moth by the lamp is burned. The fish dies without water. Dear indeed it's such love. How can I live without seeing him? My heart is nothing without him." Again, you know, Mahadevi looks upon Shiva as her lover. And she tells in one of her poems, "Oh Shiva, when shall I crush you on my pitcher breast? O Lord, white as jasmine, when do I join you stripped of body's shame and my heart's modesty?" In fact, Mahadevi Akka rises above the body. She says, "You can confiscate money in hand. Can you confiscate the body's glory? To this shameless girl, what is the need of cover and jewels?" And she openly, like I mentioned earlier, she says that I am not a woman, but neither am I a war. You know, she says, "You have come seeing the beauty of rounded breast and the fullness of youth, brother. Brother, I am not a woman. Brother, I am not a war. Brother, seeing me again and again, for whom have you come? Look, brother, any man other than the Lord who is white as jasmine is a face I cannot stand." So, you know, the only man who matters is her God. And Jana says, you know, she openly calls herself a slut. She says, "Cast off all shame and sell yourself in the marketplace. Then alone can you hope to reach God. Symbols in hand, a veena upon my shoulder. I go about. Who dares to stop me? The pallu of my sari falls away, a scandal. Yet will I enter the crowded marketplace without a thought." Jani says, "My Lord, I have become a slut to reach you." So therefore, you know, what these women were doing, through these emotional outpourings of bhakti, these women found the moral courage to stand against the patriarchal political authority. These women, bhaktas, negotiated patriarchy and created an alternative space for themselves, which survives even to this day in folk memory. But it is delegitimized in mainstream history, highlighting the fundamental disconnect between history writing and the type of sources used to essay history. You know, like I've already mentioned, most of the sources through which we write history in the archives are mostly about men talking about their deeds. But we have to turn to these kind of sources to get the experience of women. And the bhakti poetry becomes a very important way in which this can be done. In Hinduism, the devotion of a wife to a husband and a complete merger in him is the highest aim, even if the husband is a fain. But the women in the bhakti found courage to defy this, and they either walked out of their houses, they walked out of these restricted spaces of patriarchal control, or they, you know, changed their husband's way of thinking. Like I've already mentioned, the majority of the bhakta saints were very critical of women, though they were revolting against idolatry, tyranny of caste, creed, along with the temple, its rituals. But in the change that they sought, women were not included. They were protesting vocally against the prevalent injustice in society, but they conveniently left out the women, relegating her to the background. In the change that the men were seeking out, women had no place. And at the same time, you had a number of these women saints who were leading a very non-traditional, non-conformist life, and they were talking of individual freedom. The Bhakti saints did not attempt at reorganizing social relationship within the family. In fact, they even marginalized the women, pushing them back into domestic sphere, because to them, women was the ideal woman was one who was an obedient wife, a pativrata or sati savitri. And it was at this time that these women bhaktas were negotiating patriarchy and creating an alternative space for themselves. So therefore, you know, we can really write history. We can write a women's history from the point of view of women if we analyze the writings of these women. So the Bhakti women saints come across as a very new category of women who were defining the world in their own terms and how they wanted to live. Thank you.